Grace, mercy, and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. October 31st is Reformation Day, which of course is also Halloween Day, which is the day before All Saints' Day on November 1st. One Halloween, a group of kids were trying to impress their pastors by dressing up as All Saints for the church's annual trunk or treat event. So the kids arrive, and there was this girl dressed up as Saint Teresa, a boy dressed up as Saint Joseph, and another girl as Saint Clair. But then there was this kid in a dog costume. Well, the pastor notices that one of the kids stands out in this great cloud of witnesses, and the boy realizes it too. But without pointing out that he chose shaggy hair instead of a long robe and floppy ears instead of a glowing halo, the pastor kneels down, gets on his level, and with gentle compassion reassures him, "You know, Saint Bernard is my favorite saint too." So what does it mean to be God's holy saints? If it's not what you wear or where you're from or even necessarily what you do that's important, then surely it's deeper than that. Well, I want to approach this question in depth, but first to consider something else together, and that is a Lutheran understanding of sainthood, that we are all children of God, who are at the very same time both sinner and saint, and that our identity as saint and sinner changes the way that we relate to God and to each other, because as both saint and sinner, we recognize that, first, we are not perfect. Second, that we need each other to be and live at our best. And third, most importantly, that we all need a Savior. And that's where God's grace comes in. The true, forgiving, compassionate love that is communicated through the gospel, this good news from God's word that makes us one and prepares a place for every one of us at the kingdom table. And you know, that's one of the reasons that we often hear the saints described as the holy hosts of heaven, the faithfully departed who have gone before us, our beloved loved ones, prepare a place for us as our hosts in God's house. It's interesting to me that we hear in Luke's gospel Jesus preaching his most famous sermon from a plain rather than a mountain. Because you know, not everyone will have that mountaintop experience physically or spiritually in this life. Some will, for sure, but some won't. Yet many more of us can relate to a flat road, a steady road, or even a hilly plain. Well, we often refer to the gospel for today as Jesus' Sermon on the Mount because Luke uses some similar language to Matthew's gospel. But Matthew's account is different. Today we hear from Luke, and Jesus is not preaching from a mountain at all. Luke wants us to know that Jesus comes down to the plain places, and that when Jesus gets down, we pay attention. Even though it's often called the Sermon on the Mount, that's just not the way Luke tells it. Jesus does trek up a mountain in Luke's account, but it's not to preach. It's in order to pray, to spend time in God's holy presence. And then after a night of prayer, Jesus appoints his disciples, his followers, giving them a new calling, a new focus, a new path to follow. And that changes things when Jesus gets down with us. Every year on All Saints, I become particularly sentimental. It's a time in the church year when we remember and celebrate the lives of those we have loved and who have grown closer in the presence of God in the past year. One of the people, as I said during the children's message, that I always remember on this day is my grandmother, Marilyn, whose birthday is November 1st, All Saints' Day, a good German Lutheran woman who was raised in eternal life with Christ on what is arguably the most Lutheran day of the year. Any guesses? Reformation Day, October 31st in 2002, the day before her 79th birthday. She was a dedicated Lutheran, to say the least, a descendant of the Schrader and Schwedfeger families who immigrated to the United States in 1838 by ship. In fact, I was named for my great-grandmother, Mary Vay Schwedfeger, and a quick online ancestry search will show you each of their names on the passenger list at Ellis Island. But you know, considering the gospel for today, I can only imagine what it might be like to scale up a tall mountain to pray, or traverse a dry and hot, wide open plain in order to preach, let alone board an overcrowded ship, set sail across the ocean to seek God's will for your life and for your family's future. And when I imagine what's at stake in such a journey, I cannot imagine taking it without Jesus, going at it without God. It seems to me that our ancestors experienced faith conquering fear. And so we too are called to follow in the footsteps of the saints when Jesus calls on us as his disciples. What strikes me in both of these stories, from the vantage point of Luke's gospel and in my own family's story of immigration, especially considering that it's All Saints Sunday, is this profound presence of sheer vulnerability and accommodation that we see here so clearly taking place. That when we allow ourselves to be vulnerable to God's will, open, fearless, and faithful, freed in Christ, then truly there is a place in heaven and on earth for everyone who will hear God's word and choose to live accordingly. The crowds flock to Jesus to listen, to be cured, to have demons cast out and their needs for safety and salvation met by his abundant power. These people are vulnerable to the extreme, and Jesus knows this. So rather than mocking them or taking them for granted or even inviting them up on a spiritual pilgrimage to the mountaintop, Jesus comes down in their midst. Jesus talks with them, and Jesus meets with them in their vulnerable and needful state. And friends, here is our answer. Just who are God's holy saints? Well, on this All Saints Sunday, we hear it in the words of Scripture. Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you and when they exclude you and use the name of the Lord against you. Because according to God, to recognize your own vulnerability is truly what it means to be a saint. Not to be perfect or to be particularly religious or even to become known worldwide for the works of the Lord that you have done. No, but to be vulnerable to the Lord's will. So that in your openness to solidarity with God and the saints, and that means with each other, together we remember that whether in times of joy or great need, we are called first and foremost to turn to God in prayer. And you know, that's because there is this deep connection between the gospel message for today and All Saints. Because death and grief are some of those things in this life that remind us of our vulnerability and our need for holy community. Because no one is exempt from death. Because no one is exempt from fear. Because no one is exempt from loss. And friends, that means that everyone has been given this incredible gift of grace from God. All Saints invites us to live into the words that we spoke half a year ago on Ash Wednesday, words filled with mercy and love and compassion and resurrection promise. Remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All Saints helps us remember and give thanks for those who have returned to dust, caught up in the promise of God, who is the creator of every living thing and who continues to raise those who have died to new life in Christ. Vulnerability is one of those things that, if I had to guess, we would all much prefer to avoid at all costs. But while to be vulnerable is uncomfortable, it is also what makes us human. Even Jesus, in his divine human identity, was vulnerable to life and to death. Romans 6 reminds us, "For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection just like his." Brené Brown writes that when we try to numb those things that are uncomfortable to us or that pose a risk to our lives, like feelings of sadness, grief, and vulnerability, we also numb our capacity to feel present and future joy. Friends, the church at its best is a people and a place which reminds us of our gift and ability to be vulnerable to God's plan together, and that it's not something to shun or to deny, but that God has promised to meet us on every level of human experience, all the way from brokenness to divine blessing. This is why Jesus came down from heaven and why he comes down off that mountain to equip the saints, to bless the whole world, to teach us how to love without exception, and to truly be God with us in every time and place. Thanks be to God. Amen.